I'm the convener, but I'm going to shut up and let my neighbor take over.
I wanted to draw one brief diagram. I'm going to be very brief. It's not my own research.
Don't apologize.
I'm all for diagrams.
Yes, exactly.
It's a great diagram. And it's actually the mathematically smallest diagram I can do for you, as well as being short. So I'm just going to pull this up here and I'll bring it to the center.
Wow.
Yeah, sorry. You probably don't have to show the screen. You just tell the diagram. So I know there's. I'm obviously this is taken as given, but there's many people who know this much better than I do. So. But I'm just. I wanted to be really clear about what for me the renormalization group is, how scales, physical scales, turn into levels, how the argument goes for emergence. In a very trivial sense, so it's not deep. I don't get to do all of the contingency and accident stuff. Quite after, I can't explain traffic jams, right? So traffic jams are the emergence, these sort of these unstable fluctuations. I totally contingent. I can't do that. I can do the synchronic emergence. So I'm just going to draw the picture.
Are you going to define the normalization group?
I will show an example. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So I'm just going to do a very simple thing. So imagine you have three cards. Okay, so 1, 2, 3, and they're in order, right? And I can do the following thing, right? I can take 1, 2, 3, and I put the third card on top, so I can cycle, right? So I'm just going to do cycle. So now it becomes 3, 1, 2, right? So I'll call that the C operator, right? And I can cycle again, so it becomes 2, 3, 1, right? And then I can cycle again, and notice that I've done this correctly, and it goes back up to the top, right? So this is a little counter. It counts to 3 and gives up, right, and cycles back, so it counts modulo 3. So this doesn't exhaust all of the operations I can do on my deck of cards, right? So there's a whole other set, and I can access that set on my computer here, my group computer, with the swap operation, okay? So I go 1, 3, 2, and I just swap the bottom two cards. Right? So I've accessed new states of the system, right? So if maybe that's evolutionarily useful, right? And I can do 3, 2, 1, like so. And again, I do the swap operator. And of course, swap is reversible in one step, like so. It's its own inverse. And then, of course, I can also do 2, 1, 3, like so, right? And so one thing you notice here is that the swap operator modulates the cycle operator. So in fact, now cycle on this side takes the 3 and puts it up there, and I go down. But here, it takes the 1, puts it up there, I go up. Okay. So this is actually a really simple computer, okay, that I can use. So this is like a these are functional states, let's say, of a biological system, right? So this is called the dihedral group, right? It's the smallest non-abelian group, I think. So I often think about these are also.
I don't see why. On the right, why that's going up?
So C, the cycle operator, means take the card on the bottom and put it on the top. So here I took...
Okay, I see. Okay,
right, I took...
I didn't see the C there. Okay.
Oh, yeah, sorry. Yeah, right. So this is very simple, right? So this is group theory. You can extend this to semigroups, and that's what we call a finite state machine, which is like the base, the most simple possible computer, the base, the computational complexity hierarchy, right? So there's this amazing thing you can do.
I don't know. Is group theory has these axioms? You know, there must be an inverse and whatever. Are those necessary for finite state machines?
No. So they're semigroups.
Yeah.
Semigroups.
Oh, that's what a semigroup.
And I'll kick that in a second. So what I can do here, there's a great theorem proved in 1963 about this. So this is the group theory case, and doing this has been known since the 19th century, right? I can coarse grain all the guys on the left. I either don't detect them or I don't care about them. It's evolution. It's not robust to use these things because the noise will swap you around. So I can just coarse grain them and say big guy here, big guy there. And what I get is instead of this nice thing that counts to 3 and can reverse the direction, right? Instead, I just get a counter that counts A and B, okay, with C. And so when I hit this guy with the cycle operator, I can't see any effect. Or with the, sorry, this should be swap. Thank you. Okay. So I just coarse-grained a computation, okay? And this is the renormalization group for systems that are not organized spatially, right? in the renormalization case for physics, right, you take things that are neighbors to each other, physically nearby or physically in space-time, right? And they have lots of degrees of freedom, and you take the nearby ones, you kind of summarize them, you decimate or you average, right? So that's just what I've done here, except I've used the group structure, okay, to do that decimation or averaging. Okay, so I say I'm not going to look inside A or look inside B.
This is the old school definition of decimate.
Yes, yeah. So it's, and this is, and this is an equivalence class. So in group theory, and also in the theory of semigroups, okay, there's a, the sequence for which you do this is fixed, right? So this is the Jordan-Holder decomposition. So give me any group, right, and I can decompose it by successively coarse graining, by what's called modding out the normal subgroups. I can successfully decompose into these coarse grained states, and let's just say I had something more complicated than this, right? I would have a couple more levels. So this is the most fine-grained level. This is fundamental theoretical physics, right? And down here, this is, you know, psychology, right? Okay. So that's the simplest possible way to talk about renormalization in physics, right? So I just wanted to make a point, which is this is the bottom of the computational complexity hierarchy. Okay, so these are groups, and this also works for semigroups. Okay. So it works for irreversible processes, for finite state machines. Once you go above the hierarchy, once you go one step up to, let's say, the context-free languages, any kind of computational system that's more expressive than the finite state machine. So the Turing machines are up in the stratosphere compared to these guys. These guys are at the bottom. Any step further up, there's multiple coarse grainings. There's basically no theorems. Mathematicians don't even think that's even decidable how you can coarse grain consistently. So there's going to be multiple inconsistent coarse grainings, okay, of the same underlying system as long as it has expressive powers greater than the finite state machines. Right? Is this?
I'm not sure what incompatible means. So you can only do one at a time, or you don't even know if you can do any?
So here, right, I had to lump these guys together mm-hmm. and these guys together. If I had done, let's see, these guys here, I wouldn't have a group. I wouldn't have something that functioned. It would have illogical consequences. I would be like, people would say, that's a bad theory,
yeah.
Right? And the only way it can do it is governed by the Jordan-Holder decomposition.
Or you couldn't stay within the theory, at least.
Exactly. Well, I would have a bad group. I wouldn't be a group.
You wouldn't preserve the group structure.
I wouldn't preserve the group structure, right? So I wouldn't, the theories, instead of being legitimate English language theories, would become bizarro world theories, where words stop meaning what we used to think they mean. So this is true for the finite state machines. But once you go up to the anything higher, more expressive, anything that can play, for example, parenthesis matching, right? I have to balance my parentheses, right? That can't be described by the finite state machines. So once you go above that level, and I guess I'm just going to... Okay.
Wait, so you're saying parenthetical statements are above the finite state machine level?
Matching parentheses are above finite state.
Can you encode them also in the same level somehow? Like make an encryption where parentheses just map to some...
No.
You really can't.
You really can't, right? So these are strictly less than.
Because of the computational complexity hierarchies?
Just, exactly. I mean, I misspoke. Computational complexity is usually about space and time scaling, right? These are sort of pre the 80s, before we cared about P versus NP, right? These are just, you can prove, for example, that you can generate sequences, right? You can prove, for example, that a finite state machine that accidentally generated some good parenthesis matching expressions would also be forced to generate non-balanced expressions as well by something called the pumping lemma. So strictly,
so it's a non-obvious reason.
It's a non-obvious reason called the pumping lemma. Okay. So I just want to draw one more thing. Okay. Right. So this is great. Right? So if all of our theories were group theoretic theories, everything we're saying I think is totally trivially true. Right. Absolutely. Like I can see A's and B's, and I just need a bigger machine to blow up the A and see what's inside it. Right. Or an fMRI or something, and I maybe need a lot of power. Right. But you can do these decompositions. Right. So you can do it in our computer algebra. It's great. Not in Mathematica, but...
Now you're going to tell us we can't do that?
Well, I'm going to tell you that once you go above, right, so here's how the sort of structure, the logical entailment, it totally is logically entailed, it's, so, you know, here's dihedral group, so what I just drew you, right, and that kind of coarse grain renormalizes to the Z2, okay, and there's, you know, maybe this was a coarse graining of some more complicated group and all the way down. Right, that's fine. Right, when you have a system that's more complicated than groups, right? Okay, so I have a theory that I express not with group theory, but with something slightly more expressive, like a parenthesis matching game or the structure of an algebraic equation, for example. Right? there's no good way to, first of all, I can't give you an algorithm to coarse grain it. And I can't tell you basic things, like I have two theories, A and B, okay? Are they equivalent? It's undecidable, it's logically undecidable, okay? So I can't even tell you, two guys have theories, okay? If they're at least context sensitive, or sorry, context free, if they're at least that, I can't tell you if they're equivalent. In general, let's say they both are coarse grainings of C, right? I can't, these coarse grainings could be incompatible. So B says something, and A says, that's crazy, that's downward causation. And B says, no, actually, my theory's great. Your theory's the one with downward causation, right? Because, you know, what you were lumping together, I have to split apart, and what I split apart, you lump together, right? So I can't tell if these things are the same, right? These guys will have two incompatible folk psychologies, let's say, okay? And I guess, I mean, this is not necessarily, okay, a problem if, you know, still, in this picture here, you have some foundational theory, okay? But whether or not A is actually a coarse graining of C, say you find them by different methods, that's undecidable. So there's all sorts of problems that kind of sneak in, I think, even for the synchronic case.
But you're thinking of coarse graining just in terms of understanding. You're not thinking of some physical process which forces two different coarse grainings of C and therefore lead to two different outcomes A and B.
No, this is just understanding, right? So this is, I have to teach psychology, so I'm going to coarse grain over your neural states, right? I'm going to say, this is the module, that's the module.
This is just theories of the world.
Exactly. So maybe to put this, right? So say your student writes a really terrible C program, okay? You can't, it's undecidable how to lump that together into nice modular procedures, okay? There's no way to do it. It's just taste or whatever. However you overcome Gödel's incompleteness theorem is how you have to overcome this problem here.
I'm not sure what undecidable means in this context. If I have finite theories, can I just go through all the possibilities?
If they're finite, absolutely. Okay. But context-free grammar is context sensitive. These cross the boundary from the finite state machines, which are the top level of the finite guys, and they cross the boundary into the infinite.
Is important.
Exactly. And so undecidable just means if you believe you have an algorithm to do this, you actually believe something logically inconsistent.
Okay.
Yeah. And so
don't we know that thermodynamics is a coarse graining of kinetic theory?
We know many facts about mathematics, but that doesn't mean we can know all mathematical facts.
But we know we can't know all mathematical facts.
Absolutely. Yeah, so I had this quote. So somebody said, physical... Somebody said this, physical theory fixes all the physical facts. Obvious, right? And I'll just, in a second, was that you?
Okay.
Yeah, okay, so that's obvious, right? That's no more true than, I wrote, mathematical logic fixes all the mathematical facts.
No, but I think Alex said physical theory fixes all the facts.
Okay, so the a fortiori fixes all the physical facts.
Yes.
And that's not the case.
Okay.
At least that's my claim. Obviously, you're the first guys to hear me make these claims because no one writes them this way. There are some people who, when they proved the semi-group version of the Jordan-Goldberg decomposition, which happened in 1963, one of the guys, John Rhodes, makes this point about, essentially, do people believe anything above the semi-groups could be coarse-grained in this rigorous way to produce this chunk?
Is Simon at?
Yes.
I have a tactical problem.
Okay.
I don't know whether I should wait till you're through, and then I can say, okay, because maybe as you keep going, gradually the mists will dispel, and I'll see. Or whether I should stop you right now and say, I don't know what you're talking about.
Yeah, I agree.
Okay. Okay.
Can you say it in English?
Okay. Yeah. Well. Okay. I can say it. Can we?
I'm the undergraduate here.
Absolutely.
Say, what?
Okay. So let me go back to this imperfectly erased board.
Yeah.
Okay. So what I had here, I had a picture of a computation. So the way I teach this is very simple, right? You're on Southwest, right? And the plane lands, and they have to count all the passengers in the seats, right? So if the stewardess or steward has a dihedral group handy, okay?
As a what?
A dihedral group. So this is this object here, which can be implemented by three cards, right? She walks down and she does the cycle as she walks and she's counting modulo three. Does that make sense? Every time she sees a passenger, she hits the cycle button and goes one step down.
Yeah.
She has to count modulo three, so she hits it again, she goes up again. So it's not a great counter. She could buy a larger one,
right?
But every counter has a limit, right? So she does that, okay? She gets to the end of the aisle, okay? Now, you know, the passengers leave, they get back on. She has to make sure that it's the same number of passengers. She hits the swap button, right? She does the swap operation on this system. right? So these here are the internal states of the system, right? Does the swap operator disarranges the system in a certain way, and now walks back hitting the C operator, she counts backwards, right? So this is, and at the end of it, if there's the same number of passengers, modulo 3, at the end of it, she should arrive back at this state here.
So she has to keep track of the how many times she runs through the cycle?
No, these things keep track of it for you because you're cycling down one, two. Let's say
only
two
passengers. She doesn't care how many passengers there are. She only cares how many passengers there are in mod 3.
Right.
And she wants to make.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, okay. So this is just
with the mod 3.
This is just the kind. It's a simple computer. Probably simple computer.
It's
a finite
state.
But yeah. Is this making sense? Okay.
Yeah, the overall point is still.
Yeah, but I guess
me.
I don't.
Okay,
there's some importance to the fact that it's a group. There's some reason why you're saying it's the group, mm-hmm. and that's because you want to. If I'm,
mm-hmm.
I'm just trying to see if I understand.
Yeah.
It's because you want to say that there are certain ways of coarse graining that are consistent when
mm-hmm.
there's groups.
Yes.
And when there's not groups,
mm-hmm.
you lose.
You lose all of that decidability. Yes. So.
But go back to explaining it the way you were explaining it.
Yeah, sure. So that's a computation. So if you're a follower, a disciple of Putnam, you think that this is the origin of all consciousness. I don't know, right? If you're Chalmers, right, you think Somerset's a qualia. Why? Because they implement functional states, right? So this deck of cards is a set of functional states. It's responding to its environment, all sorts of things.
It's a very simple computer. Right.
Very simple.
I'm on board with that.
Okay, great. So now you want to do the same move that was so successful in 20th century physics that gave us all of the quantum field theory, why we think string theory has to be the right theory, all these sorts of things, right? Which is you're going to coarse grain the underlying system.
Now, say a little bit more what you mean by coarse grain.
Thank you. This is great, Dan. Thank you very much. So what I mean is I'm now no longer going to say I can tell the difference between these three states. I'm just going to say I'm going to call all these states states of type A.
Do you know how many there are?
Yes, in this case there's three.
I mean, but that's part of your coarse graining, but not that coarse graining.
So this is the property of this particular coarse graining.
Well, the coarse graining means you'll forget how many.
Yeah, you don't know.
Yeah, you forget how many. Yeah.
Indistinguishable. They become indistinguishable.
You become indistinguishable.
Right, so like I say I have skin, I don't care how many specific atoms actually go into skin, something like that.
Yeah, or it's like you failed an exam, I don't care which questions you got wrong. Right, your grade is 96, I don't care if you missed A, B, and C.
Would it be easier if your grade was just like a B? Would it be really coarse graining?
Yeah, exactly. You can coarse grain further. Exactly. Yeah, thank you. Exactly.
So basically, if I get it right, you're actually asking a question about isomorphism. That is
homomorphism, but yes.
Homomorphism, right. That is, if I ignore these features, there's still a higher level homomorphism, which it will map back if I ignore
mm-hmm.
the details. Yeah.
Yeah. So you might say, this is too complicated, right? Summarize this for me. Coarse grain it. I don't need to know all your neural states. I just want to interact with you with my folk psychology. I don't need to know. There's many different patterns of neural firing that could make you.
Yeah, okay.
So I'm going to just say these are all one clump, and these are all another clump.
Yeah.
And I unify them, and I get a much simpler computation, which is the count mod 2, the binary counter. Right?
Will you go on the first plane or the second plane?
Yes. Or am I counting up or counting down? It's like the little LED on the side maybe will tell you that. So this is a coarse graining, right? This theory here, right, is logically derivable from this theory here. And I mean logically derivable, I mean I can get a computer to do it algorithmically. It's exponential in time, but it's MP, but it's not, you know, it's not hard.
Just to see if I'm correctly forecasting, you're going to try to make the argument
mm-hmm.
or implying that you're going towards the argument that there are some things where you can't do the reductionism. Is that where we're?
Well, yes. I'm going to show some features of this.
Where you can't do the emergence.
Where you can't. Right. So imagine. Right. So like, just to give some examples for the physicists in the room. Right. Not that they need them, but you know, imagine this was a huge thing. Right. I keep coarse graining it, and the computations keep changing. It just means I'm going to some fixed point. Right. Eventually, I'm going to coarse grain, and maybe it's, you know, maybe I have some enormous counter, and I'm just coarse graining. It kind of looks the same at each point. Right. Each time I do this, in this case, there's only one jump, and after this, I just have this two-state machine. I can't coarse grain them anymore. Right. Coarse grain it to one lump, and that's it. So this is just—it's like a totally simple paradigmatic example of, you know, a high-level theory reducing to a low-level theory.
So maybe I'll take my stab at saying it in my language,
yeah.
Maybe this will help. So you have this model, theory, vocabulary, ontology, whatever you want to call it. There's six states, but it's crucial that there are these arrows between them, and they're unique. Right? You know how to go from one to the other with the different operations. And so that is what you would call well-defined. Mm-hmm. And then there's a whole nother theory model. There's two states, and it's clear how to go back and forth between them. And there's this non-trivial statement that the second theory is a coarse graining of the first theory, that you can derive the second theory by forgetting details about the first theory.
Exactly.
And in this finite number of states example, that just goes through and we're happy. And then the punchline is, once you have an infinite number of states, it is in principle impossible to do that.
It's, you can do it in certain cases, but in general, things like entailment, so...
You'll never know.
You'll never know. There's no sort of universal principle for doing this, right?
Universal principle for doing what?
So I'll do the example. So from here, I coarse grained and got this high-level theory. I can tell this is consistent with this. I can tell that, you know, all the behaviors this produce, I can get from a coarse graining of behaviors this produces, and so forth. Now, say I have a model of a process that I believe is more sophisticated than that that can be represented by a finite state machine. Say I have some theory, right? And so, for example, if we believe people are Turing machines, our theory of psychology is something, right? Say I have some theory in which I can't represent this way. Many things become true. So for example, I might have two theories that are actually equivalent, that predict the same behaviors, but just by looking at the structure of the theories, I can't tell that they do that. It's undecidable.
You can't tell they do what?
I can't tell if they, okay, technically, I can't tell they recognize the same language.
I'm thoroughly confused. You could be saying one of two things, and you're probably saying neither, but these are the only ones I can think of. One is that there are systems, formal systems, physical systems, which cannot be the coarse graining of some other system, or you're saying that there are systems to which the renormalization group cannot be applied so that no other system can be gotten by coarse graining them. Are you saying either of those two?
I'm saying neither exactly, but In that same constellation, so let me be explicit. The renormalization group prescription is not unique. I can coarse grain the same system in two different ways to get two theories that are incompatible. And what I mean by incompatible is one recognizes one fundamental object, the other one says it's composite, and vice versa.
Right.
So you
wait a minute. What I still don't see what it means by incompatible, because They still are constrained by whatever the data are that they're theories of.
A finite amount of data.
Right.
But
so
not
then,
the infinite.
So then they, so they, that means they make different predictions about something you haven't looked at yet?
It is always possible that two theories that agree in all the finite data will disagree in something you haven't seen.
Well, that's
yet.
Just Duhem, right? Yeah.
Who?
Duhem's thesis.
Okay.
Yeah,
we think our physical theories are
formal
theories because they predict about infinite numbers of events,
impact
on counter with infinite.
Yeah, so one way to think of it, I think, is that this is one way to formalize Duhem's thesis.
Okay, so.
Okay.
I think I'm on board with that.
Wait, I guess
I
I'm confused about
what that's about. Physicist.
Duhem was a French physicist of the late 19th century who argued that all physical theories are empirically underdetermined.
Uh-huh.
And that therefore there was no rational basis for choosing between them. Or at any rate, he said things which have suggested that to many philosophers and historians of science subsequently.
Yeah, I don't think it would be so strong, but he would say, you're right, I think that some philosophers overreacted or overinterpreted or whatever. But his point was logical, that is, even though the data are compatible, maybe compatible with only one theory, for instance, at the moment, in fact, alternative theories, you can have new data that will...
Yeah, it's closely related to Quine's thesis,
yes.
And in particular to the claim that two total theories of the world could be mutually, logically incompatible, and yet agree about all empirical observations.
Right. Right.
But it's also important that Duhem didn't just make this as an abstract, general, philosophical point. He made it in the specific context of work in mechanics.
Yep.
Right. So there was actual mechanical systems he was
right.
talking about.
But it
has
been generalized.
Yeah. Well, no, he didn't generalize it.
Right.
Subsequent people generalized it. Duhem said it about mechanics,
yeah.
Right?
I guess
the
I'm
Quine
confused.
Thesis is a much more general version of the Duhem thesis.
Yeah.
It seems to me that you're adding an extra ingredient, I mean, the conversation is, which I'm a little confused about. So one is just saying there are theories of the world, and one is saying that the evidence that's gathered about the world is consistent with both those theories. That seems to me to be a pretty big addition. Are you saying that as well, that it's not just that I can start with fundamental theory, coarse grain, and get two incompatible theories, but rather those two incompatible theories are also consistent with the evidence that's collected about the world?
Yes, and that would also be the case. So okay. Sean talks about I can take statistical mechanics and derive from an anarch, so I forget which way it goes, but
yeah.
I take one of them and I derive the other, right? So that's true, and you know that's good, right?
Wait, but that's not this case.
No, and that's not. So but here's the kicker, right? So absolutely, I can take a high-level language, and I can coarse grain it. I can get a simple
high level means
low level.
Sorry, finer grain theory, super fine grain theory.
Yeah.
But describing, say, a Turing machine or something computationally sophisticated, anything better than this, right? I can take that theory. I can coarse grain it. I can get a new theory, and I know that's okay. That's fine. I can do that. But if somebody presents me with a theory that has the expressive power of a Turing machine, right? I can't. It's undecidable in general whether that theory is a coarse graining, is derivable from a fine grain theory, say fundamental physics. It's undecidable whether one of these things is compatible with the other.
But they're both consistent with the world.
They're both consistent with a finite amount of data, yeah.
And so, could you in fact be lucky and figure out how to derive one from the other?
Could you figure out and be lucky
are they
about
automatically,
an undecidable proposition?
Are they automatically undecidable for sure?
So it's undecidable, the equivalence of context-free grammars is undecidable.
Okay.
So you could get lucky, but it's sort of hard to say. It's like getting lucky about the continuum hypothesis. It's actually a matter of taste, right, whether or not it's true.
I mean, a real example from Kant, the history of the efforts to build so-called micro-foundations for macroeconomic models just constantly crash into this problem.
Right.
So people call. I mean, it's amazing how here's a no one ever learns theorem, right? Over and over again, enthusiasm will break out in economics for building building micro foundations of macro models. Well, we should learn and stop, right? Because every one of them crashes into this problem fairly swiftly, right? That you wind up with more than one way. Right, of reconstructing your macroeconomic, you've got a bunch of data, you build a you test a macroeconomic model, you test it, everything fitting very, very nicely, and then it turns out there's more than one macroeconomic story that you can tell about it, right? And therefore we'll generate the macro model, because we're generating predictions, not just about macro states, but typically you're trying to generate predictions about micro states. And you'll discover that you generate different predictions depending upon which of several microeconomic stories is taken to be the foundations of the macro story.
I want to just ask a question about Don's example there. Does that mean that when this happens, you have a macro model which is
adequate
for the data
macro
you've seen?
Yeah, that's right.
And so what you'd like to be able to do is say, see, now I'm on the right track. I have this macro model which covers the data quite handily. Here's the micro model it derived from. But the trouble is that there's another micro model which, using the same rigorous derivations, gives you the same macro model. And those two micro theories disagree at some point
that's
in the
right.
future.
Well, at
yeah.
some point in the future, then
exactly.
they must disagree with evidence in the world, right? They
well,
must,
that's, I mean, that
right.
is,
so at some
that
point,
is, as
so
you gather more evidence,
you're
yeah.
calling
it
on
might
their
be
predictive
evidence
power.
From the past, but
right.
as you gather more evidence, one model will be falsified, one micro model will be falsified, and the other one won't.
That's right.
But I thought, exactly. Simon, your point was more about two macro models from the same micro, not two micro models giving the same macro.
Yes, so this is right. So two coarse grainings of the same underlying system.
So let me give you, I can give you my favorite example.
But a macro model is a coarse graining of a macro model is a coarse graining of a micro model.
Sure, but there might be more than one. So just like for the macro model, there might be more than one substrate. If we know the micro model, so if we know it's atoms in the room bumping into each other, and we've said several times you derive fluid mechanics or thermodynamics from that, right? Well, but that's not an innocent statement. You know, there's a specific process that we go through. We smooth over regions of space, and then we sort of have average quantities, and we find miraculously or semi-miraculously that we can have a theory that is sort of good in its own right and is much, much simpler, and therefore we've learned something powerful about the world. We might have chosen, because the initial theory depended on positions and velocities of the atoms, We might have chosen to smooth over regions of velocity space instead of regions of space. No one can stop you from doing that. But what you get, is a different coarse graining of the atomic theory in the room, and it would be an utter mess. It would be like this huge 10 to the 23 equations governing all these unknowns with non-local weird. It could be completely useless because there is no regularity there to be found by averaging in momentum space rather than in position space. Your logical point is that I would never be able to know whether or not those two theories, conventional fluid dynamics and weird momentum theory, were the same underlying.
Exactly. We wouldn't. There's in general no principle, and I'm kind of standing up, so I'm going to finish very quickly. But these are the kinds of points that you get into. It's not so absolutely. You wouldn't know if these two could actually be derived. You couldn't tell if they were. In general, there's no rule to tell if these are actually the same or they agree, right? And so I guess it's maybe a cautionary note that even the synchronic emergent stuff is hard. Physical theories fix all the physical facts. It seems obvious and it seems like it's got to be true, but it's no more true than mathematical theories fix all the mathematical facts.
So let me ask a quick question, just to cut beyond this.
Yes.
There's sort of two classic ways that people have divided emergence theories. One is epistemological and one is ontological. We've been arguing over the ontological side of things. You've told me about a model theory that says there's an epistemological problem here. How does it address the ontological question, or can it, or does it?
That's a lovely point. I think you're absolutely right. This is what the story is, epistemological. Mm-hmm. And then I think I don't know how to get an ontology on epistemology, but I'm not a philosopher. I don't know how to do that. So I'm going to sit.
Can I ask if you think one of the big points that can be made by looking at it this way, which I think is actually pretty interesting, is that there can be like undecidability or something in the attempt to go from one level to another. Mm-hmm. I mean, but in some sense, if we all agree that our goal is not to implement the program of trying to coarse grain the lower theory to derive the higher theory of psychology, for instance, you know, then isn't that okay? I mean, does it impede us in the larger goal of having explanations by starting at the larger level, I mean, higher level, you know, instead of, it certainly impedes any program that wants to start at the fundamental level of physics to try to describe psychology, but we've all agreed nobody wants to do that insane program and that it's going to have much poorer explanatory power than starting with a set of laws at the higher level.
I guess maybe the one thing is that this entailment between levels, what that means to go between one level and another, seems to me to be a really hard problem.
But I think, like you said, this is so far just epistemological, not ontological.
Yes, and so the...
So you haven't given us any pause about whether or not it's, you know, in reality entails.
Mm-hmm. No, absolutely. But so I don't want to go back to... I mean, we can go a lot of ways in this.
Yeah, let's not go back there.
Okay, but so just that question of what that entailment is between those two levels. If it is a certain kind of... you know, logical, derivable kind of thing, I think that's actually a pretty sophisticated question that is not transparent, and it's a project for naturalism,
so
maybe. Right?
Let me go back to my economic example, because I think it's real, right? And it's also much less radical than psychology and quantum physics, right? I would contend, I think this is the story most consistent with the history of economics. We know quite a bit about macroeconomics. We've got good macroeconomic models. Not, you know, there's lots we don't know, but we've learned quite a bit about macroeconomics. If you want to, if somebody wants a microeconomic explanation of why macro model A or the group of macro models A is superior to a group of macro models B, you want a microeconomic explanation of that? In general, you can't get it. Can't get it. You've got to tell a macro, if the explanation of the superiority of one macro model over another is a macroeconomic explanation. I'm going to use macroeconomic relationships to give you the explanation. I'm not going to go down and give you a micro story.
But maybe that just means that microeconomics does not entail macroeconomics. I mean, nobody's claiming that that's the case, right?
Both of these subdisciplines operate largely independent of one another, except when one fails utterly, particularly macro, and then the microeconomists say the reason you failed is you don't have micro foundations. Yeah. And then they produce an alternative which isn't a macro theory at all, and then we get a crash of the kind we had in 2008, and the macro modelers begin again, disregarding the idiocy of the micro modelers.
Right.
But I mean, look, it's not like we've got completely mysterious phenomena here either, right? We know what we're trying to talk about, right? People buying and selling things, right? So this is not the phenomenon one's trying to account, and we've got tons, you know, one thing about economics is, especially recently, there's lots and lots and lots of data. Relative stability in the data, there's error, but we know how to, pretty good theories about how the errors are distributed. So the computational problems are not intractable. And yet, even with all of those things going for us, right, the track record of successful micro foundations of macro models is hopeless, right?
Can you say a bit more about what this hopeless task is? What would a micro economic foundation for macroeconomic theory look like if there were...
So first you would need a macroeconomic theory that actually obtained over a long period as a result of relatively fixed institutional constraints. And then you'd need to show how the rational calculations of individual agents when aggregated produced these macro variables and their relations, interest rate, money supply, fiscal deficit, and other similar variables. Since we don't have the first, right, there's no point looking for the second.
Well, no, all right, but that you're more skeptical than I am, Alex. So, and you're so skeptical that the interesting problem goes away, right? I mean, if you think that we know nothing whatsoever about macroeconomics, then, of course,
I'm sorry. Well, let's not turn this into debate. You happen to have two philosophers of economics here. We're pretty soon going to be arguing about issues that have nothing to do with naturalism.
Let me push this a bit farther, because I want to go from the epistemological to the ontological here. And the name I'll bring up is Paul Humphreys is not here to sort of defend this story. But his story is analogous to this in a variety of ways. He says
his story's about emergence.
Yes, about emergence, yes. And so the analogy is something like this, and I'll just sort of wave my hands through it because it's a complicated story. But that is that things get lost as you move in scale. That is, you lose, the information disappears, so to speak. It fuses, as he says, so that the details cannot, in a sense, move up or down in an interesting way. Laughlin also, in physics, makes a similar kind of claim, that there's some kind of loss of information in this process. By that is loss of, where the differences don't make a difference as you move up and down. And as a result, what he says is that, in fact, you can't go back and forth like this. There is a sort
of... there's a lot of abstract language here, but no tangible examples. If Stephen were here, I guess he would say that's hogwash, because you don't lose information in physics as you go from one level to another. Can you give me an example?
Let me get out of physics, because I think...
All right.
Just to give a simple example, you lose information as you go from the specific position and velocity of every atom in a room to the temperature of the
presence. Yeah.
But that says nothing about whether one the lower level intelligence is the higher one, right?
We're
talking epistemologically.
Yeah, okay.
So what I want to get at is a similar relationship in biology. The question is, what are the parts and what's the whole? I'm made up of a bunch of molecules. If I do a synchronic story and I say I've got hemoglobin molecules and all the molecules that make me up, am I just this collection of these molecules? Well, in fact, the molecules are each made by each other. They don't exist independently. They wouldn't exist in the world if there wasn't this complex. In one sense, to describe the parts, you already need to know something about the whole, and you need to know something about its history. There's not a nice, neat compositional story to be told here. It's a compositional story across time, in which the reason that I have hemoglobin, and that hemoglobin is such a hugely, highly probable molecule on the surface of the Earth, has this incredible history, which is always involved in animal bodies and oxygen. In that sense, you can't decompose the body and say, okay, all these molecules, this explains the body. The molecules each explain each other in a troublesome sort of fused way. And in a sense, it's an analogous kind of fusion in which you can't do this sort of myriological reconstruction.
I think that you are mystery mongering what is probably the clearest case of reductionism in all of molecular biology. And in addition, the diachronic history from the beginning of the formation of the Earth until the point at which oxygen begins to not be a toxin,
right,
and begins to be an agent of life, right, is also something that is entirely explicable from a molecular biological
perspective.
Not,
I want to be clear that I'm not saying it's
Richard
not.
To confirm or disconfirm what I've said.
So I want to be clear that there's nothing that I've said or suspect here that has anything that is not based upon fundamental laws of physics. That's not what I'm claiming, okay? What I'm claiming is that the specific molecules that make you and I up are the result of a series of accidental features in which they have constrained each other one after the other after
the
other.
What do you mean by accidental features?
Well, the
only accidents I can see in this whole scenario are quantum mechanic indeterminacies. If aside from those, the whole thing is predictable.
I mean, besides the fact that the whole base of it is indeterminate.
Well, except insofar as indeterminacy affects the course of biological evolution, we don't know that. I mean, I think it does because mutations are probably quantum phenomena.
Yeah, yeah.
But it's still at the bottom of the laws of physics.
But the original arrangement.
I'm not disagreeing with that. That's the funny thing about this.
Yeah, I agree.
I have. This is not about magic. This is about trying to figure out how best to describe these phenomena. And what I'm trying to suggest here is this notion that we're getting at, I think, has relevance not just epistemologically, but I think it has relevance in actually the ontology of the emergent process. And that is that things, information gets lost as you move up, or as Anderson would have said, that it, you know, in a sense, you can't get back to it, you can't figure out the details, the details don't matter.
Information gets lost, but structure also accrues.
Right. Constraints accrue, yeah.
Can I try something kind of like some kind of student? We're all friends here. So there are principles that are different from laws, right? So we have, Sean mentioned, a very short set of what we believe to be the fundamental laws. But there are lots of principles that those laws obey, and those principles seem to apply at many different levels, if I can stretch it right now, try to think it out as I'm talking. So, for instance, conservation of energy. You know, you talk about laws of economics, and those must respect this principle, conservation of energy, right? And that is not a fundamental law. It's simply a principle that's respected by the fundamental laws and is able to carry on. After we coarse grain and lose some information, we somehow retain things like that. A principle of least action, things tend to fall along the path of least resistance. It seems to be universally true. Again, it's not a new fundamental law that I add to matter and gravity, but matter and gravity respect this.
I think the problem is that sometimes you do lose the principles. I mean, if your system is open, then energy is not conserved.
Right, but that's...
You lose
right.
universal invariance.
Sure, okay, but it's part of how you are defining your system, et cetera. So as long as, okay, so it sets some boundaries.
Right.
You know, you define your system in such and such a way, your law of economics might not, you know, be uniquely, because I guess I didn't fully appreciate why uniqueness was being invoked earlier, be derivable from quantum, you know, field theory versus some other field theory or some other, theory. But it must respect this principle, and that is deeply tied into the foundational law. Is that interesting or relevant at all, or is it just totally irrelevant?
Wait,
are you all going to just like turn away and go back to the previous conversation?
It's deeply tied into.
Sorry.
Your last sentence.
Oh, I just mean this reductionist idea. It isn't so much that there is some unique outcome of the coarse graining process, or even that every theory of economics has to have as its foundation only one unique set of fundamental laws. I mean, this uniqueness seems to me to be not necessary to invoke. But what is necessary is that there are some principles that survive the coarse graining even when information is lost.
Yes, fundamental physics constrains everything.
Yeah.
That's
so,
not an issue.
Nobody here is arguing for magic. I mean, I think that we have to be really clear. I don't think anybody here is arguing for magic or for mysticism, for that matter.
Or that you can escape fundamental physics, right?
Yes, that's right. Fundamental physics works. The question is how to think about these problems of transition and of what we've been calling levels. And yet take into account the fundamental changes of causality at the gross
gross level, at the coarse grain level, as you would call it, that we see, the fact that living processes look like they're doing things very different than non-living processes, that mental processes look like they're doing something very different from just physiological processes. We want to explain those. And there's some fundamental shifts, whether you call them phase shifts or whatever, we want to have an explanation for it that does not say, well, I don't want to investigate this because there's nothing interesting there. It's all just basic physics. Of course, it's more than basic physics. There are principles. You want to call them principles. I would call them changes in boundary conditions or constraints. Those are what are interesting, and that's what I want to focus on, not the fundamental physics, or if the fundamental physics has somehow changed, you know, as we move up the ladder. It's
so,
not.
I mean, you used the example of hemoglobin. Could you give us an alternative explanation for the evolution of hemoglobin?
No, but I could give you all... whenever organisms have evolved to the point where, as you say, oxygen is no longer a toxin, oxygen killed off most of life, you know, when it first appeared. But there are lots of ways we can actually get oxygen and move it around. In fact, even on Earth, there are two kinds of globins that do this, the cyanoglobin and hemoglobin. Yeah. They are...
Or take photosynthesis. I mean, you evolved in a variety of different substrates.
So, right? And again,
there are some
is...
constraints, so there's many ways in which photosynthesis cannot evolve.
That's right.
But there's more than one way in which it can. And right. functionally pluralistic.
So this is the multiple realizability question.
Yes.
It's the variation of the functionalism story that says, okay, how do we account for that? What are the rules that we will use in this game to account for this that don't violate fundamental physics, but help us explain how these things converge and why they cross certain thresholds when they do?
There's, I think, a vivid way of seeing the epistemological point. Laplace's demon and a biologist who isn't Laplace's demon are both looking at some planetary histories. And the biologist says, one of two things is going to happen. Either you're going to get hemoglobin or you're going to get cyanoglobin. And that depends on factors that I can't say. And Laplace's demon is going to say, how do you know there's just two? Mm-hmm. And that fact is a principle that you get from the higher level because they're both consistent with the underlying physics. But biology tells you that, I'm sort of making this up, but that there's the two ways it can go. And you don't know which way it's going to go, but you know it's going to be one way or the other.
As a biologist, I wouldn't say there's just two ways to go. There's two ways it has gone.
Yeah, right. But it'll probably be a metal that plays the role, copper or...
I mean, I guess I don't understand what's new here. As an evolutionist, you really can't predict what's going to happen because it's contingent on random mutations that are essentially unpredictable in my view, and environments which are very difficult to predict. So we don't know what's going to happen.
It's also complicated because the mutation that produces a change in the organism that changes the environment, that changes the selection of the organism. So you get this incredible nonlinearity in evolutionary biology. The remarkable thing is despite that nonlinearity, there's lots of convergence. And that tells us there's lots of constraints out there, and it'd be nice to know what those are. And that's what biology is about, finding those constraints. They're not about new laws of physics.
Yeah, maybe I can usefully derail the conversation because there's just a couple of the topics I wanted to get to in the session that draw on what we've been saying so far. We talk a lot about, you know, the relationships between the different levels of description and so forth. But there are certain features of the actual evolution of the universe and life on Earth that seem to be important. And I wanted to know what people feel about their universality and how important they were or how robust they were in some sense. So one, at a very, very abstract level, is just the development of complexity. From the early universe, which is very simple, it became more complex. Our best theory now says in the future it will eventually go away, that the complexity is a temporary phenomenon. And maybe even the better one to talk about is natural selection. And that might go back to the teleology questions. When we talk about the origin of life, you know, at what point, even if we don't know the origin of life, if we can talk about what might have happened, at what point would we say, okay, now natural selection is operating? And at the development of society or memes or anything else, is there some demarcation, some phase transition in which we say, now it is a useful thing to talk about pressures of selection acting on these different pieces of information traveling through time. Is that something that is this is not something that's understood by me, so is it something that's understood by other people here?
So physics is committed to the claim that wherever adaptations emerge anywhere in the universe, the only way they could do so is by a process of blind variation and environmental filtration.
Okay.
And that assurance is vouchsafed to us by the second law of thermodynamics.
Okay, I agree on that.
And of course that means that if there is complexity and diversity that shows adaptation, it's the result of Darwinian process. And that's guaranteed by physics.
No, I don't agree with that.
I don't think the physics is committed to that at all.
Say that again?
Say that again.
That if there is diversity and complexity that reflects adaptation, then that could only have emerged from zero adaptation via the second law processes as dictated by physics.
What does it mean for a bit of complexity to be something?
Show adaptation?
Adaptation, yeah.
But to
is that taking the question a little
bit? No, adaptation is going to be cashed in terms of some combination of stability and replication.
Well, let me see if this characterizes it. Slowing the clock down for a moment, say, you look and click, every now and then a mutation happens, physics explains why, cosmic ray, whatever. Click, click. Now, most of those
are non-adaptive.
Non-adaptive. Once in a blue moon, one of them is adaptive.
By the second law.
And which ones are adaptive is a function of, depends on A, the second law, and on the myriad details of the particular environment which it happens.
Right.
So that's the role that history plays.
Right.
And so evolution is an amplifier of historical accident, and when it starts amplifying, it amplifies blindly.
In accordance with second law, amplifies wastefully minimal energetic states.
But something that follows from that, I think, is that it's a mistake to ask at what point, where do we draw the line and say, above this is adaptation, below this isn't. Because every thing which is manifestly an adaptation is actually preceded by an indefinitely long sequence of things which are maybe.
I'm willing to accept that, subject to the understanding that at the start of the process there's zero adaptation.
Sure.
Okay. And then the merest, slightest first unit of adaptation is the product of the operation of the second
law. Sure. There's no.
And every subsequent addition is also the operation of the second law.
Yeah, but I'm not sure what that...
That's all I was trying to say, by saying when adaptation appears, it's driven by the second law.
Well, no. See, that's what I'm not going to go, because all you're saying there, and I would agree, is that all of that adaptation is a process that better be compatible and is facilitated and made possible by, among other things,
the second law.
Fine. But there is nothing about the second law that I can see that says that there will be adaptation.
Absolutely.
In any particular...
Exactly right.
Right?
There.
Which means
it could have been that the universe existed for too short a time or existed
right.
for a very long time without the first slightest bit of adaptation
occurring.
Because the second law is probabilistic.
Correct. So doesn't that imply that, therefore, natural selection and adaptation are compatible with but not determined by the second law?
I come in on Alex's side this time. I think that there is this debate we always have with the creationists when they say, life couldn't have just happened because the second law says everything winds down and so forth. And I think that's a misunderstanding of entropy in the second law, and Alex would certainly agree with me there. But I would even go further to say that forgetting about life and adaptation and just sticking to a somewhat easier to define notion of complexity, I think one can make the argument that the evolution of complexity from simplicity requires the second law. requires the entropy, you know, to be way far from equilibrium, mm-hmm. and entropy is increasing. And mm-hmm. I almost want to say, except then Alex would start disagreeing with me, that the reason why complexity appears is because the universe wants to generate more entropy.
No.
Sean, I'm just saying that.
Yeah, you know, Sean, but still, I don't understand why you're saying that. You're putting it that way, or Alex is putting it that way. I mean, nobody's denying here that evolution requires the second law. Mm-hmm. We're simply saying that that's not the only thing that it requires, and therefore the second law doesn't determine it.
No, I agree, but there is
right.
there's
a difference
ground in between those two statements you made, which is that I would say that there is a sense in which evolution or complexity or whatever is sort of a spin-off of the second law.
Okay.
And it's not just that it requires it and also other things. It's that it's a very natural consequence under very wide ranges of conditions.
But I think
we don't know.
What Massimo is concerned is that nobody make the mistake that Richard pointed out before. And that is of thinking that there's something like momentum in evolution. So that, right, you think, well, the second law is going to guarantee. No, it's going to guarantee nothing, because maybe every evolutionary track we look at dies out almost immediately. Yeah. It happens eventually that some things, but don't think that. That once it gets going, it's bound to continue.
Not only really that, but when you say it happened under a wide range of conditions, we don't know that.
No, we
don't have
that.
N equal 1, remember?
That's fine.
Right.
So let me give a tiny little bit of data, which is very, very, very tiny, but it's the data that I have. And again, since I'm a physicist, I'm thinking about complexity more than evolution in particular, but I think the complexity would come first, and then you can start talking about evolution. So the level of my ability to understand things is mixing milk into coffee. So if you imagine, you know, you have a little bit of milk on top of your cup of coffee. That's a very simple system. Milk's on top, coffee's on the bottom. And I'm defining simplicity versus complexity as sort of the Kolmogorov of complexity. That is to say, how much data would I need to give you to fully tell you what you were seeing when you looked at the thing. So if all the milk's on the top and all the coffee's on the bottom, that's it. I just described the whole system. It's simple. It's also low entropy, right? It's a maximal separation between the milk and the coffee. If I mix them all together, then it's again simple. They're all mixed together. That's all I need to tell you. In the coarse-grained description, mm-hmm. The information is conserved, actually, in the fine-grained description, but it's in the coarse-grained description. It's very simple, but it's high entropy. It's as mixed as it could get. So the interesting question relevant to this discussion is, what is the trajectory from the simple low-entropy configuration to the simple high-entropy configuration? And it allows for the appearance of complexity. You can have swirls of the coffee and the cream that are very interesting, and you know, maybe there's little life forms that form in them or whatever, okay? It's just a model of the whole universe. The universe was simple and low entropy. It will be simple and high entropy. It is now complex and middle entropy. But, and so I think you can do it, and I have done it, you know, with collaborators. You can sort of ask, well, under different models of how the milk and the coffee mix, how does the complexity evolve? And if sort of the milk and the coffee are non-interacting with each other, moving separately, then you get a little tiny bit of more complexity, but then it fades away. If there's a tight coupling between the milk and the coffee, so that there's only changes at the interface between them, then you get more complexity along the way before it goes down. So I have no idea whether this is sort of robust and fascinating and interesting and universal and explains the existence of life. But you can imagine sort of this kind of analysis moving from the second law, which is the foundation of all this stuff, to what other sets of constraints do we have to put on to say that not only is entropy increasing, but the way it is increasing is favors the emergence of complexity and even adaptation and life. So I agree with Massimo in the sense that, yes, I don't know the conditions under which it happens, but figuring out the conditions under which it happens seems like a very reasonable research program.
So the one thing that's missing in your story is, of course, something analogous to memory, something analogous to genetics. That is, in order for this process in life to get more complex, it basically has to remember It can't forget what happened the last generation. It can't throw all the information away. You have to accumulate that. You have to accumulate the mutations or whatever, and throw the vast numbers of those away, but have something that allows you to accumulate this.
And maybe that's the answer to when you can start talking about adaptation. Well,
and the key is to accumulate it, you have to continually regenerate constraints, which take work, which generate entropy. That's not a trivial question. How do you do that? That seems to me a question that we've ignored. We say, yeah, okay, it reproduces, it copies, and we got more of this stuff, and it passes on. I think it's a totally non-trivial question to add to this problem of, yeah, okay, more increase of entropy in the total, and yeah, there's self-organization that can show up, but it's a bigger story than that.
And as I understand the origin of life issue, which is not very well, again, there's a metabolism first school of thought and a replication first school of thought. And since I'm a physicist, I like the metabolism first school of thought because energy and entropy are involved. Mm-hmm. And I can certainly imagine there was this intermediate phase of life where you probably should call it life. It was metabolizing. It had structure and complexity. And it couldn't replicate yet, right? And so there was no adaptation. There was no natural selection in any useful form. But it was
there
life.
There was natural selection. There was no response to selection.
Fine. Very good. There's no adaptation. Right?
That's right. So why does it stick around?
Well, stability. There was just enough
thermodynamic stability.
Yeah, I mean, you know, there's enough of it, and it wouldn't have stuck around forever unless the adaptation kicked in. Yeah.
Okay, so this is sort of a side point, but one thing I love your example of the mixing coffee, and this is sort of a very very institute thing that people do. And one thing that always drove me nuts when I was doing this, people said, "Oh, you should look at the algorithmic information complexity. Look at the Kolmogorov complexity. That's great, you know." Except that's uncomputable.
Yes, but it's very easy to estimate.
There's some asymptotic bounds you can put on it, but there's no, I mean...
Remember that you're a physicist, not a mathematician. You can do it, I can, you know.
No, I know I'm not a mathematician. but
there... You can compress the file.
Yes, Lempel-Ziff compression is, you know, but that's not complexity in, that's complexity relative to a scheme. Lempel-Ziff is complexity relative to an intentional world, just to put it there, right? There's no intention-free notion of complexity.
And that's okay.
It's even... Okay,
so that... And it may be okay.
There's no
intention-free...
There's
no intention-free notion that does the work that we want it to do when we say... Like, Kolmogorov complexity, algorithmic information complexity, has... That's uncomputable. Every approximation to it is relative to, in this case, the 1980s needs for smaller files on floppy disks.
Okay. And I would argue that that's the same kind of true statement as saying, well, if you're Boltzmann and you're defining the entropy of something, you first define a coarse graining, and then you say that the entropy is the number of microstates, logarithm number of microstates in that equivalence class defined by the coarse graining. Mm-hmm. And someone else comes along and says, but I could have coarse grained it differently. And mm-hmm. I will say, so what?
But there's a sort of systematic relationship between the coarse grainings, right?
No, so, there's no universal right way to choose the coarse
grainings. And that I think is tricky. So, you know, the coffee example is lovely, right? Because we look at the coffee and we say these are beautiful, obviously complex structures. One could imagine aliens come down and they look at a system that for us is totally boring, right? And yes, it has a totally boring trajectory from zero to high entropy. And we don't see any complexity at all, and they say, this is great, we watch this on TV all the time.
Yeah, no, I deny the existence of those aliens.
So you do? Okay.
I do, and I'll tell you why. Because I think that when you look at the cup of coffee, mm-hmm. you're looking at it with your eyeballs, and you're using your normalization group, your coarse graining, you're mm-hmm. using the actual laws of physics in the actual world. Mm-hmm. You're saying, what I have access to in this low-energy world in which I live is the photons coming off of that coffee. I can't see every molecule of milk and coffee. I can see the colors coarse-grained over whatever resolution my eyeballs have. And the aliens are going to have eyeballs or photon detectors or whatever, and they're going to have a similar... They might be better or worse at it than we are, but they're not going to see momentum spaces in some way that we don't have access to, because it's the laws of physics. It's the Hamiltonian of the world.
So evolution gives you the standard by which you measure complexity, the evolved cognitive systems.
The laws
have.
Of physics, the standard model of quantum field theory gives you the standard.
So let me ask you something. I'm the cup of coffee, okay? I've got all these things. I get redundant fingers, redundant arms, and so on. As a result, Kolmogorov-like analysis of me would be compressible. right? Okay. Now, imagine I'm stirred up like a cup of coffee, and all these molecules are mixed up and so on, and my fingers are who knows where. You know, there's no such thing as fingers or anything. Which is more complex?
Right. So, I mean, that's a perfectly fair question, and I think that these notions of complexity need, you know, there's a walk to take from any of the notions that I was taking advantage of in that little discussion to what we care about when it comes to metabolism and life and replication and information being passed along. And so, you know, I have a very specific definition that was relevant to the cup of coffee.
Absolutely.
In the case of the second law, I have a very specific definition that is relevant to the evolution of the universe. And I don't need to find the one true definition. I think that, you know, we find that these are, again, I could just be Alex and I could just write down the quantum state of the thing and evolve it using Schrodinger's equation. And anything else is what is useful to me.
But see, I would agree. I mean, I'm not disagreeing with that for a moment. But if you put it in terms of all I need is what is useful to me, it seems that what we keep doing here throughout the afternoon is to switch back and forth. Even though we have the distinction mentally clear, but we keep switching back and forth between the epistemological problem and the ontological problem. If you conclude a sentence with all I need is what works, you're talking epistemology, you're not talking ontology. And we have agreed that the epistemological problem is in fact irresolvable for all practical purposes. That there's not going to be a universal reduction of, you know, economics all the way down to quantum mechanics, epistemologically speaking, but that's not particularly interesting. The interesting question is the ontological one. And the problem is that we keep switching back and forth, sort of deploying epistemological, on both sides, by the way. I've been doing it as well this afternoon, right? Because I've been asking the ontological reductionists to say, well, how do you not bother by the fact that you cannot epistemically reduce things? I think you should be bothered. But we're both playing this same kind of game. It seems to me that, I don't want to sound too ecumenical about this at the moment, but it seems to me that really, there may be some reasonable arguments on both sides, ontologically speaking, but that the ontological question is really something about which we ought to be agnostic. We really don't have a knockdown argument either way, far from that. And all we have is what I think is a clear epistemological limits about which we all agree, and we draw different conclusions from those epistemic limits that I suspect, I don't want to be in too much folk psychology, goes down to our personal preferences. I mean, some of us really like this idea of, no, there's going to be one answer and that's going to be the one at the bottom, and others like our ontology to put it as down put it on the more rainforest than desert like. And it's like, okay, but we don't really have a knockdown argument or even anything close to that either way.
But you have to admit the weight of the evidence is on the side of reductionism, isn't it?
No, now you're invoking an aesthetic preference for
desserts.
It's
not aesthetic. That's what Stephen said. I mean, we can derive so-called higher levels.
Now, why do you say it's aesthetic?
You can't go the other way, and there is no case in which we show that it is that higher levels are incompatible with it.
Well, but what I want to know now is why anybody thinks the ontological question is interesting and needs a solution.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I mean, the epistemological question, I think, is very important.
Yes.
And
well, what do you mean by that? Because I keep saying ontology, just you're talking about, can we predict?
Can we actually do
that
it?
Dan
is saying that the question of the nature of reality is less interesting than the question about the extent of our knowledge.
Well, I wouldn't necessarily agree with that. Because
I would amend that.
You're right. That's what I'm saying. I'm saying that any... inquiry about the nature of reality, which isn't an epistemological inquiry, is already off into cloud cuckoo land. It's undecidable. We don't know what we're doing. It's something where you make up the rules as you go along. And I think the only thing that disciplines a consideration of ontology, the very idea, you know, where do we do ontology? We do it in practical areas. To me, one of the really interesting things is that the term ontology, philosopher's term, where it's really playing an interesting role these days is in computer science.
Yeah.
Because computer scientists, programmers, are having really interesting discussions, arguments, theories about what the right ontology is for doing certain sorts of tasks.
Especially in medical and health profession areas.
But there, the term ontology has a real bite, and you can see how different ways of conceiving of the objects that your program has to be about makes a big difference. To take a trivial example, the elevator problem. You want to have a system that controls multiple elevators. Turns out to be a tricky problem. If you want to optimize, you don't want to have redundancy and so forth. And so people scratch their heads and they think about this in a very abstract way of what's the Umwelt of the elevator? What's the manifest image of the elevator? What things does it have to keep track of to do the job we want it to do? And it turns out that the best ontologies for elevators, they have to have each other in a bank as sort of agents in the equation. They have to sort of keep track of each other as agents. They have to get sort of game theoretic in order to make sense of the problem. If you really want to write, and now look how fundamental and how sort of reductionistic this is. This is brute practicality. You're a programmer. You have been given the job of making and optimizing a control structure for a bank of elevators. And you come back at the end of a long and brilliant analysis, and you say, well, the first thing we got to do is we got to endow the elevators with a sort of game theoretic sense of them of themselves as agents in a multi-agent world, and then it goes like a bandit. Now, that's a really interesting discovery about ontology in a very constrained space. And I think that if you don't have a task like that, and you want to talk about ontology, you want to talk about what's really real, you know, other elevators are real for the elevator. Good, interesting fact. There's the things that are real for us, the things that are real for Stone Age people living in the Amazon. These are all, back to Stephen's point at the beginning, there's all kinds of reality. But I think all of them are tied in a quite strong way to epistemology. And anybody who says, then there's the ontological as opposed to epistemological problem, I don't know what that's about. I don't know what would count as getting it right or wrong.
So, Dan...
But Alex, you're not happy.
Epistemology was in the saddle in philosophy, for, at least from the time of Descartes, and what it brought us at the end was the positivism with its proscription of a large number of the questions that we naturalists wish to answer. And, of course, there's a significant interaction between epistemology and ontology that they influence one another, but in particular because those of us around the table, particularly you, have been in the forefront of advancing a causal theory of our epistemic states. You have a commitment at least to ontology being on a par with epistemology, and at least many other philosophers conclude that unless ontology is somehow prior to or more fundamental than epistemology, we are going to find ourselves back in the positivist cul-de-sac. And we're not going to even be able to treat the questions of naturalism as meaningful.
Well, that's a diagnosis which I am not persuaded by at all. You might be right. I think the fact that sort of an overextension of epistemological concerns led to logical positivism, that's true. But I don't think that the corrective to that
is to go back to medieval ontology.
Right.
So the question is, what's the middle ground? And I think that the middle ground there is that whenever you make an ontological claim or you reach an ontological conclusion, that thing better be significantly linked to to your epistemology.
I think that's a very fair statement, and I would be inclined to say, I regret that Weinberg isn't here, that Weinberg would insist, and Jerry has insisted all afternoon, and I would join them in insisting that the history of science constitutes excellent epistemological grounds for that ontological claim.
Which particular ontological claim? Sorry.
The reductionist, unificationist claim
that he has been defending, that I defend, that Jerry...
You do.
I just think that you're misreading the history of science.
Yeah.
No, I think that... I find myself to the right of all you guys, because I think that it's more than a history of science claim. I think that our evidence... You know, again, if the standard model of particle physics plus gravity is right, then it just says what happens within its domain of applicability and all the other levels...
Yeah. But the epistemological stand from which you make that claim has to do with the number of decimal places to which the predictions are accurate, which exceed that of any other theory.
Let me just put it in this way. I think that my basis for making for believing that the standard model plus gravity does hold in the regime which I think it holds is as good as, for example, the epistemological status of the claim that the sun gets its energy from nuclear fusion. I think that the logic that leads you to that conclusion and the evidence, therefore, is the same. And that's not a history of science claim.
No, that's just a way of doing science claim. By history of science, I simply mean the successive increases in the precision and range of our predictive confidence.
Yes, but as we said earlier, there are different ways of looking at the history of science, like Anderson that was mentioned before a couple of times, including by Weinberg, who said actually the direction of the history of physics, fundamental physics, is that it's become increasingly irrelevant to the rest of science. Precisely, one would argue, because of the failure of a reductionist program. So, you know, as you can see, there are at least two different reasonable ways of looking at the same situation and drawing very different conclusions there. I really don't think either side has a knockdown argument.
I don't think there ever was such a reductionist program, right?
But I think you're saying you don't need
to invoke the history of science, but you really ought not invoke the history of science. It's simply a logical argument. That's what Sean's saying.
It's a theoretical argument.
It's a logical argument.
What is the reductionist program? Is it the attempt to predict higher levels of lower levels, or is it the attempt to show consistency?
Well, that's an excellent question. So the reductionist program actually is a multitude of programs. Because there is an issue of reduction in the sense of, you know, can I predict higher level phenomena from lower levels?
We all agree we can't, right?
Yeah, right. And then there is an issue of theoretical reduction. Right? That is, you know, can I actually come up with a principled way to show that chemistry in principle is just physics, or that biology in principle is just chemistry and therefore is just physics? Okay, that one I think is more interesting as far as our discussion is concerned. And my reading up philosophical literature is that the majority of philosophers of physics, philosophers of chemistry, and philosophers of biology seems to be convinced that no, that program has not worked. Nobody has actually articulated a reasonable way of doing that reduction, other than saying, well, it's logically possible, therefore nothing. It doesn't follow that. It's logically possible, sure, but you have to do the actual work.
It's logically inevitable, I think, is what you're saying.
If you buy...
Yeah, but how? Based on what principle?
Based on the principle that physics is...
It's not enough. The standard model is incredibly good at the domain of application to which it actually properly applies. It says precisely nothing about any other domain of application.
Yeah, how about what it says about this thing? All of solid state physics comes from quantum mechanics, right? And the technological reliability of what we can do with that knowledge is incomparably greater than it's ever been. And it suggests that higher level phenomena are fundamentally caused by lower level phenomena.
First of all, some solid state physicists or philosophers of physics would actually disagree, not on this particular example, but on the generalization of that principle. Nobody here is denying that we can deploy fundamental physics to do stuff even at higher level, including this stuff. The claim is not, nobody's claiming that, so let's not put up straw men here. The claim is that, yes, you can do certain things, and then there are other things for which you need new principles that you'd have no principled way to reduce to those fundamental things in physics.
Where's the burden of proof? On those who've succeeded so far or on those who claim that you won't be able to succeed in the future?
Again, depends on what you mean by success. If by success you mean the standard model works in the domain of application which it has applied, yes.
But on the other hand, that program now.
But every week we keep increasing the range of application.
Not
consider
really.
Consider decoherence and quantum locality.
Yes.
Right now it's 1,000 molecules. Next year it'll be 10,000 molecules. Why are you putting a priori limits on the powers of microphysics?
As I said, I'm not talking about a priori limits, but I think that it's too easy to say, well, the burden of proof is on your side, considering that there's been a lot of theoretical failed production.
We haven't even reduced Mendelian genetics to molecular genetics.
But you're
hey, don't get on that subject with me.
Yeah. You're confusing the failure of reductions and the failure of us to be able to use lower levels to predict the behavior of others.
But with nobody disagrees with that, within certain limits.
Pardon?
I mean, nobody's saying that using lower level principles we can make certain predictions.
Yeah, we all agree we can't do
right.
that.
Right.
So, do you have a replacement for the reduction of things for physics?
Yeah. There's this stuff that we talked about several times today about using models in physics, for instance, in phase transitions that actually make use of things like singularities, mathematical singularities, not as a problem but as a feature of those models. Those are very reasonable, viable ways of thinking about emergence. They're operational. They're mathematically sound. They give you the information that you want. They don't invoke any spookiness out there of any kind.
But
so
you're saying it's conceivable that they're inconsistent with the reduction
of
program?
No,
that's inconsistent. The funny thing. I don't know why anybody would think that anybody around the table thinks that inconsistency.
Well,
no,
but I guess that I'm not understanding what
they're consistent, but they're not sufficient.
They're independent and autonomous.
Right, they're new properties.
They're new properties that are not derivable from lower.
So, I have a very, very simple question that has to be a yes or no answer to. So, if can I be Laplace's demon?
Can what?
If I knew the quantum state of 1 million light-year cubic region around us, and I knew exactly what everything was doing, and I knew all the laws of physics, and I had infinite computational power, and I did not know the laws of thermodynamics or economics or biology, could I evolve it forward just using the laws of physics and get the inevitably right answer, or would I get the wrong answer?
To the distribution of matter at the end of that period of time.
Yeah, to within the theory, what the theory talks about. I mean, is the theory complete in
okay,
its own
okay, now you
sense?
Tell me, but I got the impression that you couldn't because of basic things in physics like decoherence and non-locality.
No, I don't think that's...
You can't.
I mean, it's a quantum mechanical version of Laplace's demon, but the Schrodinger equation, is deterministic. It says what will happen. We can talk about wave functions collapsing and probabilities, but I think that's a red herring for this argument. It's still, so I will predict the probability of it happening rather than it happening, or we can be many worlds or whatever. I'm just saying, is the theory complete, or is there something that we get wrong by not knowing the higher level description?
I'm going to make
a little distinction here. So I think it makes sense to say, I have a big computer, I simulate it, at the end I have a distribution of matter, I look at it, I see the economists, right? But what I think bothers people is the relationship between theories. Not the relationship, not building a simulation and running it through, but we want to know if our theory of psychology is consistent with our theory of quantum field theory.
Right.
It's derivable,
not consistent.
Derivable
is far too strong.
Derivable is strong, right? We want to know those if those two theories are the same. It may be the case that we won't know. Now, it might be said every good scientific theory, eventually we can sort of see how the construction will go.
No, but you're avoiding my easy question by asking a hard question. My easy question is
if you run the simulation,
you get an answer, and is the answer right?
If you run the simulation and you at the end you get the distribution of matter and you see the economists, I think is there anyone who disagrees with that?
I don't think so, but I just want to make sure.
Okay, sorry.
Let me give you an answer. Let me give you a tentative answer because again, this is I want to actually see what you think about this. So from the stuff that I read recently, one possible answer would be yes, you get an accurate description of the positions or properties of matter at that level. You get no information at all about, let's say, the temperature and pressure which some of that matter transitions to from liquid to the vapor. Because for that, to get that, you need additional boundary conditions. You need something else.
No, I mean, I think that any boundary condition I might need is included in I just said a million light years across, I have, right? So if I'm only predicting 1 year in the future, there's no boundary conditions that can possibly affect.
So ultimately, let's say that happened,
Laplace's demon is back there a million years back. Got this cubic light year. I look down here and I say, this looks very busy to me. So Laplace's demon is predicted that I think that this is very busy. That's mm-hmm. that's your claim.
What does it mean? You think it's very busy?
Oh, no. So I have this experience. This rug has got so much stuff on it.
Yeah,
it's aesthetically troubling to me. You know? Now, so Laplace's demon is going to explain that piece, right?
Well, I didn't use the word explain.
No. What's he going to do? Is he going to predict that that's exactly...
He's going to predict the location of every molecule in the room.
No, I understand that. I'm not worried about the molecules in the room. I'm worried about that I just thought this thought. And what does that mean in your story?
So what it means is that... There are interesting true things to say about the world that description that Laplace's demon is using doesn't know about. That, I think, so that's the interesting part of emergence in my mind, that the way to find the laws of the special sciences, the way to find the laws of economics and biology and even chemistry or solid-state physics is not to take the standard model of particle physics and renormalize. Okay, everyone agrees on that.
Yes.
And nevertheless, we can experimentally, and by being scientists, and being by almost all the scientists in the world, do things other than particle physics and find regularities that are interesting and true and useful. And nevertheless, it remains true that I don't need to know about those regularities to answer questions that can be phrased in the language of the fundamental theory.
Sure.
Yeah, there's, yeah.
What? Yes.
And that crucial glass caveat, right?
Wait, no, what's
that? Dan, go on.
There's an old example of mine, which I think is apt here, where we imagine a prediction contest between Laplace's demon and an earthling. Mm-hmm. And how the Laplace's demon can actually interact with the earthling to have a contest is tricky because...
Separate universe.
Because Laplace's demon, we're supposing, does not conceive of the earthling as an investigator.
Right.
Okay, because it's a mass of atoms.
Right.
But for some, you have to give me that bit. So they're going to have a prediction contest. The earthling picks up the phone, and a phone rings. Earthling picks it up and says, "Oh, you're coming for dinner? Fine. Will you stop off and pick up a bottle of wine on the way home? Great. See you within the hour." Click. Now, the Laplace's demon, with its total knowledge, predicts this incredible trajectory of the person who was on the other end of the phone, stopping in traffic, starting in traffic, stopping at a bottle shop, buying a bottle of wine, and arriving at this destination and bringing the bottle of wine in. That's the same prediction that the earthling makes, namely, there's going to be a bottle of wine sitting on this table in 1 hour. So the Laplace's demon has a problem, given that the Laplace's demon is working it out just from the physics. He sees, and he even predicted, that the earthling would make this prediction. But he knows how he made his prediction. He had to track every bloody atom in the whole universe, practically, in order to predict this. And he can see that the earthling doesn't have access to all that information. So the earthling's capacity to win the bet, to make the same prediction, is going to look like magic to him unless he has the intentional stance and can see that the earthling is an agent that has beliefs and desires, that understands the language that's being said, that trusts the person on the phone, and so forth. If you don't have that level, you're both going to make the same prediction, but the Laplace's demon is going to be baffled by how... I'll put it sort of stronger, too. The Laplace's demon can, given that incredible infinite capacity, can predict where and when earthlings make successful distinctions, predictions. But is not going to have any resources within the theoretical vocabulary that he has to explain why. And he has to do each one seriatim. He has to do each one atom by atom. There are no generalizations that allow the Laplace's demon to say which earthlings make successful predictions when.
Are you also excluding neurological generalizations?
Yeah, I mean, Laplace's
not
demon just has
physics. He has physics, and he can't also have higher level regularities
of
a non-intentional kind.
That was the premise.
Yeah.
That was the premise. That
but
just,
of course, I think the Laplacian demon can have all the generalizations up to intentionality.
Yeah.
Because there are no generalizations that include intentionality, that's why he can't have them.
Yeah, but that's a massive begging of the question.
Well, certainly, I was only going to make the smaller point that he or she doesn't need all that. We can imagine a Laplacian demon that only speaks the language of the wave function,
yeah.
Right?
But he would be missing something. That's
well,
the point.
Well, the kind of thing that he is missing is an ability to make efficient predictions. But he's not missing any ability to make predictions about what he has access to.
In fact, he's better than
the prediction. Surely the efficiency of the prediction is partly a consequence of the way the world is actually structured,
sure.
Right?
Yeah.
So
absolutely.
The
morphology
is there is this frequency with which the guy never arrives with the bottle, and the Laplacian demon always knows when that happens.
Yeah, Laplace's demon is better, but way less efficient. And I think that,
yeah.
You know, just saying it makes it sound like
better?
We're denigrating it to say it's just efficiency. But efficiency is really amazingly important. It's a true regularity of the
yes.
world. Which
and,
is
in fact, and in fact, if the Laplacian demon is reflective, if the Laplacian demon itself has a concept of efficiency, it's going to realize that there are subparts of the world that is predicting that has incredibly efficient ways of making predictions. They're not perfect, but they're much better than a coin toss, and that will be a puzzling fact for which the Laplacian demon does not have the resources to answer, to explain why that efficiency should exist.
Even more, it doesn't even need a concept of efficiency. As you had said, it's going to seem like magic to Laplace's demon, and therefore, if he's rational at all, he's going to want to explain it, as we should want to explain it. Why is it so efficient? That seems to be a correspondence.
You cannot leave it at as a raw fact.
Exactly.
Because then I'd be missing something big about what's going
now,
on there.
Do you think that supports your view or mine?
I think that supports mine.
one observation I just wanted to make, it's hard to get in edgewise. I should know this about him sitting next to me. Just reflecting back in this morning, Jerry came in a couple times and said, well, shouldn't we define what naturalism is? And I think it's always a bad idea to try to define something. But I sympathize with the urge, something like naturalism. This is an observation about what I hear around the table. It seems to me, in addition to the discussion about epistemology and ontology, There's stuff we're running together, which is fine, about substantive questions and definitional questions and methodological. Here's what I have in mind. If you looked up in the OED what naturalism is, it'll tell you something like it's the denial of supernaturalism. And the denial of supernaturalism, of course, can come in two different forms. It could be epistemological. You could just deny something like that there are certain types of epistemic access, like that certain ways of gaining knowledge are just not allowed in our club kind of thing. So you say, voices when you haven't taken your medication, that's not allowed as an evidentiary source. Or you could take an ontological position, which would say something like, what there is and all there is natural stuff, which seems tautological, but it has a little bit of oomph once in a while, because it allows us to do what we were doing in the first discussion, talking about what's real. At least one gets on out on the table issues like that have to do with first pass, what's the furniture of the universe, and what kind of things are we inclined to let into the discussion as genuine part of the furniture that are in need of explanation. I take it, I mean, some, and then there are interesting questions. Like, some people want to let in things like bosons and fermions, all whatever the laws of physics are, and the laws of the special sciences, the laws of psychology and neuroscience, and the mental states and consciousness, and so on and so forth. Other people are resistant to that, thinking of them as overlays. Those seem to be substantive issues that would have to be carefully discussed one by one. Or mathematical objects is another one that worries some people, and other people think they could be normalized. As far as moving naturalism forward, I think what's interesting is there's also disagreements in the room about whether or not, and if so, what kind. And we'd have to specify this very carefully, the devil's in the details, if reduction is true. And if so, what kind of reduction? I mean, Terry, I thought, distinguished very helpfully between synchronic and diachronic relations. So almost no one, at least that I know, would doubt that there's, at least in the history of the Earth, there's genuine novelty. Well, there are Parmenideans around, though. There always were those who just said, well, or even maybe block universe
people
might, you know. So there might be certain people who just say that there's an epistemic access sort of funny thing going on. But, you know, so these are really interesting, I think, substantive questions that would depend on your views about what the knowledge internal to the particular science is and what its particular status is. And as for Laplacian demons, I mean, of course, a lot depends on interesting questions that are to be worked out among scientists, I take it, about whether or not quantum effects are percolating up and or what explains things like mutations that then natural selection does its work on. So I guess I just was trying to... this is one reason I resisted when Alex this morning said something like, we naturalists. I think it's a... it's a way, you know, of gesturing in the direction of kind of people who agree maybe on what they want to rule out more than what they want to rule in. And then it seems that all the really interesting questions are contested, and then smart people can talk about them. And the devil is in the details. I guess that's just what I wanted to do.
But isn't all interesting questions are contested a tautology? Don't we immediately go to the contestable questions and talk about those?
Well, see, one could though,
we could have the agreement workshop where we just say, you know, yeah, the natural world, that's what there is.
Well, see, what I think is interesting about that, the reason it's not just a terrible, it's not just completely tautological or vacuous, is because there are genuine questions about, they sometimes come up in specialized areas of philosophy when you talk about issues of supervenience and whole part relations, or, I mean, I think there are stronger and weaker versions of what people have been talking about here under the rubric of the entailment relationship from lower to higher. We saw some interesting disagreements about that. There are some interesting, I think, I continue to be puzzled. I mean, there were people back, you know, before you studied with Putnam and he was talking about functionalism, there's famous papers of Putnam and Oppenheim, I guess, talking about reduction. And the expectation really was that just give me your neuroscience and I'll show you how we can reduce it right down through the, you know, or, I mean, some people say Hobbes had this hope. You know, you do political science would be reduced to psychology to so on and so forth, and read the first 13 chapters of Leviathan and you'll see what the program was. Well, that's never succeeded. And, you know, so other people have been depending on the history of science, but my impression is no, you know, people aren't even trying. And the reason this last topic is very, very important, by the way, is that I'm not finished it, but Tom Nagel's new book makes a lot out of the fact that naturalists don't have, he doesn't think, explanations for emergence, the diachronic emergence. And I'm not, and actually, it looks like in this room there's disagreement about that. And he uses this
disagreement
to...
Disagreement with him or disagreement within the room?
Within the room.
So, I mean, naturalism has very, very often been confused with physicalism,
yep.
Right? And what we've been arguing about this afternoon is basically physicalism with but we've all been arguing naturalistically. We could have had other philosophers here. I mean, this morning there was a bit of an assumption, well, when we were trying to be clear about what naturalism might be, and everyone, we fell into thinking, well, it's denying supernaturalism, although you could allow God as long as you recognize, naturalists could allow God as long as they admitted, as long as the God proponents admitted that God could be studied scientifically, right? Yeah. But there's another group of non-naturalists, namely analytic philosophers, analytic metaphysicians, who think that there are conceptual essences, right? So we had an argument here basically about what kind of dependency relations hold between fundamental physics and other domains of inquiry. But because we're all one of the tell that we are all naturalists was that every claim was defended, was motivated by reference to some actual science. Had we had analytic metaphysicians here, they would have happily engaged in our argument about various modes of dependence, but they would have cited utterly different premises, right? They would have cited premises about the about essential properties of concepts that they take to be exemplified in various sciences, right? And those would have been utterly different discussions that would have shared no premises in common. So it seems to me we just had a naturalist. What we had this afternoon was a bunch of naturalists arguing about physicalism.
Yeah.
Nice. Could be worse. Is that an appropriate place to join? I'm sure that tomorrow will be even better. We've laid a lot of the groundwork, you know, this we did not reach complete consensus, although I kind of think that we are very close to consensus, to be honest, about many things, and then are amplifying, like evolution amplifies certain things, discussion amplifies the disagreements. So I propose that we combine the morning session, which is about morality tomorrow, with the purported afternoon session on Sunday on meaning, and have Steve Weinberg wants to start off talking about morality, and Owen's going to talk about meaning. He was going to do that. Can I let you do that tomorrow morning, Owen? Is that okay?
Sure. I think the morality is the more interesting one, and we'll sort of...
We can let it,
them tie together. It's
they go together.
They go very much
they
together.
Go to, exactly, yeah, right. So, and then I will demote you, Owen, from being the facilitator of tomorrow morning's session and ask Rebecca to do that, since you were going to be doing Sunday afternoon. Now you can't. And those of us who raised our hands have a dinner reservation for 7:30 in the main dining room. And see you then.